Well, greetings, everyone. Good evening to you all, and thank you all for coming here tonight. And this is part of our continuing series of teaching people how to get well and stay well. And for those of you who are regular attendees, you know what we're doing. It's all about ending the epidemic of chronic and degenerative disease in America by teaching people how to get well and stay well. So we have the technology to do this. We know how to end this epidemic of chronic disease, the cancer, the heart disease, the Alzheimer's, the arthritis, the diabetes. All this can be ended tomorrow with what we already know today. So we know how to do it. All we need to do is teach it and get on with it. And that's what we do here. And so to enable people to learn how to do this and to learn how to do it as simply as possible, what I've done is created a model of health called the Beyond Health Model. And all you have to do is learn the simple model and put it to use in your life, and you will be able to end disease in your life. And the simple model of health, of course, is based on the fact that there is only one disease. There are not thousands of diseases. There's only one. But we give the one disease thousands of different names because it produces thousands of different symptoms. And then we confuse ourselves and we think that the symptoms are different diseases when in fact they are not. They are all the same thing. So once we know this, it's very, very empowering to know that there's only one disease, because nobody can cope with thousands of diseases. Not even our most learned physicians can cope with thousands of diseases. But anybody can cope with one disease. Well, we also know that there's only two causes of disease. Now, the one disease is a malfunctioning cell. A cell that is not functioning the way it's supposed to function. So we're all made of these little units of life called cells. We started life as one cell, and now we're tens of trillions of cells. Can we ask them to be quiet? We're now trillions of cells, and if all of those cells are functioning as they should, then you will be healthy. There's no way you can be sick if every cell is functioning the way it's supposed to function. It's simply impossible to be sick if every cell is functioning the way it's supposed to. So the one disease is a malfunctioning cell. There's only two reasons why cells malfunction. Either they're not getting everything they need to function properly, we call this deficiency, or they're getting something that is interfering with their normal function, we call that toxicity, and there you have it. Simple system, one disease, two causes of disease, deficiency and toxicity. Now, to further simplify and to give people a tool that they can use on a daily basis, we now talk about the six pathways to disease. So there's one disease, two causes of disease, six pathways to disease, and the six pathways, think of them as six interstate highways between two major cities. One city is disease, the other city is health, and consider if you were going on all six highways toward health, where will you end up? You'll end up in health. And if you're going on all six highways toward disease, you're going to end up in disease. So what you want to do is you want to keep yourself heading on all six highways toward health. And you can learn how to do that. Anybody can learn how to do that, because here we have these six highways between health and disease. Where you are on each highway, what direction you're heading in, and how fast you're going is all under your personal control. So what you need to do is to exercise that control so as to keep yourself heading on all six highways toward health, the six pathways to disease. Well, the six pathways to health and disease, of course, are the nutrition pathway, the toxin, the psychological, the mental pathway, the physical pathway, the genetic pathway, and, of course, the medical pathway. Well, this evening, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be talking about the physical pathway. So what do you have to do on the physical pathway to make sure that you are heading toward health on this very, very important highway? Well, the first thing you have to do is something called, and everybody hates this word, it's called exercise. It's the E word. Now, historically, nobody had to do the terrible E word because they used to do the W word. It's called work. Well, of course, nobody does any work anymore, with the exception of a few people, of course. And we just sit around in front of computers and in front of television sets, and we drive everywhere, and we take elevators everywhere, and basically nobody does anything anymore. And so we are the most sedentary people in the history of the world. Well, unfortunately, our bodies were not designed to do this. When I talk about cells and how you keep cells healthy, and of course it's all about the individual cell. You have to worry about the individual cell. You have to keep the individual cell healthy. So when we talk about the individual cell, we know that we have to give the cell everything it needs on a daily basis. We know that the cell has a grocery list of things that it must get every day. If it doesn't get these things, it's in trouble. So you have to give it the grocery list. So we know that cells must get what the nutrients that they need. We know that the cells must be kept free of toxins because the toxins can shut down the metabolic machinery. The toxins can interfere with cell signaling. The toxins do all kinds of things that screw up the cell. But even if you do that, even if you supply the cell with what it needs, even if you keep it free of toxins, guess what? It's still not going to work right. And here's why. The cell also needs to be moved and stretched. So there you have it. That's why exercise is necessary. Because the cell needs to be moved and stretched. Even if you give it what it needs and keep it free of what it doesn't need, it's still not going to function optimally unless you are moving and stretching it. And what appears to happen is that in moving and stretching it, what we do is we facilitate the delivery of nutrients to the cell and we facilitate the expelling of toxins from the cell. So, that's why we need to do the E word. So to accomplish this task, the cells need to be moved, and regular physical activity that is performed on most days of the week reduces the risk of dying prematurely, reduces the risk of all kinds of diseases, reduces the risk of our leading diseases. So regular physical activity is a pretty wonderful thing. I mean, they have proven in very good studies that regular physical activity helps to prevent cancer, osteoporosis, diabetes, overweight, depression, anxiety, heart disease, high blood pressure, back pain, and disability in older adults, and that's just a partial list. Well, why not? Because if you must move and stretch the cell in order to make it work right, when it doesn't work right, it can produce any disease under the sun. So therefore, exercise will prevent any disease under the sun because it helps to keep the cells operating properly. Millions of Americans suffer from diseases and illnesses that can be prevented and or improved by regular physical activity. And in fact, there are some researchers that say that what we call the biomarkers of aging are really and truly the biomarkers of inactivity. And these are some of the top aging researchers that are saying these kinds of things. Now, because the E word is so dreaded, and it's almost a four-letter word, that's not a four-letter word, almost a four-letter word. Because the E word is so dreaded, and because we always have an excuse, it's too hot out. And certainly it was today. I mean, who's going to go out next? It's too hot out. It's too humid out. It's too cold out. It's raining out. It's snowing out. I don't feel like going out. I don't want to get dressed. I don't want to spend money to join that club. We have all kinds of excuses. Well, there is something that all of us can do, an answer, a simple answer, and it's something that I use myself, and it's really a way of cheating, but better than cheating, it's absolutely fabulous, and it's called rebounding. Rebounding. So anybody can do rebounding, and this is a wonderful answer for a lot of people, because you can do it in the privacy of your home. You can do it anytime at your leisure. You don't need to get dressed. You don't need to go out. You don't need to get a club membership. You can do it when it's raining, when it's snowing, when it's cold, when it's humid. You can do it anytime at all. And it's just bouncing on a little mini trampoline. And this is quite magical because if I were to have my water balloon with me today, but I don't, but if I had my little water balloon with me and I started bouncing like this, guess what? The little water balloon would be stretching. It would be going like this. And that's what happens to every cell in your body when you rebound. Every cell is a little water balloon, and every cell moves and stretches when you rebound. So that's the magic of it. The cells in your brain, the cells in your big toe, every cell moves and stretches when you rebound. And it uses the force of gravity to make the fluid in the cell go to the bottom of the cell and stretch the cell. So that acceleration and deceleration is what does it for you. And every cell in the body and the lymphatic fluid is also moved. Remember, the lymph system is the sewer system. And that takes away all the wastes. And we don't have a heart for the lymphatic system, so we don't have a pump like we do for the blood system. So your pump is when you're moving. That's your pump, when you're moving your muscles. So rebounding really helps to move your lymphatic fluid, and so that helps the whole sewer system to work better. And detoxing is a really great idea because it's only two causes of disease, deficiency and toxicity. So also rebounding avoids injuries. People run and they get knee injuries and all kind of hip problems. And rebounding helps to improve your balance. It helps to improve your energy. It helps with allergies and arthritis and asthma and back problems and builds bone mass. Pretty wonderful stuff. It reduces diabetes, reduces the incidence of colds, reduces blood pressure, reduces cholesterol. Pretty wonderful stuff. So I recommend rebounding, but don't rush out and go to the sporting goods store and buy a $50 rebounder because you're going to hurt yourself. You need to get a very good quality rebounder that will not injure any of your tissues and will not injure your back and what have you. People have had some pretty bad injuries buying a cheap rebounder, so you don't want to do that. And Beyond Health has a very acceptable rebounder. It's the one I use, so it must be acceptable. And I recommend it. So there you go. There's the dreaded E word, and a pretty nice solution, because you can rebound any time. And in a good time, by the way, most people in our society today watch television at least at some point during the day. You can rebound while you're watching television. So that make you feel even better about watching the television, because you're doing something useful while you're doing something mindless. So it's a good combination, good combination. Another thing that we need to keep ourselves healthy is sleep, because the body repairs during sleep, repairs and regenerates during sleep. And a lot of Americans do not get enough sleep, and a lot of Americans get interrupted sleep. They don't sleep well. They wake up during the night, and that inadequate sleep for even a few nights will lower your immunity. And of course, I saw this in spades some years ago, back in the year 2000, when I had my one cold in the last 21 years. I was coming back from Egypt, having made a speech in Egypt, and there was bad weather and the planes got canceled, and I was up for more than 48 hours without any sleep, and that lowered my immunity and I got a cold. It's inexcusable to have a cold, irresponsible to have a cold, but I got one. But I do have a good excuse for it. So you want to be sure you get enough sleep, because your immunity is quickly affected if you are not getting enough sleep. And your energy levels are also affected. You're going to lower your energy levels, as well as your mental sharpness. It dulls the brain. So dulls the brain to the point where people who don't get sleep for a few nights are involved in more accidents. So you can go out and have an auto accident where you can even get very seriously hurt simply because you didn't get good sleep for a few nights. And this is very measurable. You know, your whole nervous system doesn't function as well if you haven't slept well for a few nights. So we have to understand that. Lowers your immunity, causes accidents, and disrupts hormone levels. And most Americans are already have too many hormonal imbalances to be adding more hormonal imbalances by not getting adequate sleep. So we need to be sure that we're doing that. And make sure that, you know, there are all kinds of things you can do. Go to sleep at the same time every night. Go to sleep early rather than late. Take some magnesium before you go to bed. I always take magnesium before I go to bed. So there are many different techniques that you can do to make sure that you get adequate sleep. Another thing is to avoid physical damage. Here we are in a physical pathway. Well, you want to avoid physical damage. That means you want to avoid getting hurt. You want to avoid accidents as much as possible. Because if you injure yourself in any way, you're going to use up very precious repair materials to repair that injury. Well, those same precious repair materials are necessary for your daily repairs. So if you have to divert those repair materials from doing daily repairs to repairing your injury, then your daily repairs are not going to get done. And that means that you get older, and you don't want to do that. You get older, and you build up repair deficits, and you don't want to build up repair deficits, because pretty soon you're not functioning at all. You've got so many repair deficits. And that's why we see people running around in wheelchairs in nursing homes, enormous repair deficits. But you don't want to go there. You want to keep your body in good repair. And so avoid as much physical damage as possible. And physical damage also does another thing. It creates inflammation, and the inflammation creates free radicals, and the free radicals damage DNA. So when you damage DNA, what are you doing? You're causing more diseases, and you're getting older. And you don't want to get older. And the whole point here is don't get old. Getting old is a mistake, very big mistake. You don't want to do that. So one of the kinds of damage a lot of people do in our society is they run out and they get sunburns. You don't want to get sunburns. I remember how many sunburns I got as a child. And a lot of people who think that they really want to be healthy, they want to be super healthy, they go out and they do extreme exercise. And I see people all the time that are running marathons and doing triathlons and doing, you know, extreme exercise. This is crazy because you're doing a lot of damage to the body. So you're not doing good, you're doing damage. Avoid loud noises because loud noises also injure us. This does a physical type of physical damage. Avoid radiation. Radiation does enormous damage. But let's talk about sunlight for a moment. Sunlight is absolutely essential for human health. You cannot be healthy without sunlight. So what do our doctors tell us to do? Is stay out of the sun. And so the result of this very bad advice is that millions of people are very sick. So you don't want to take that bad advice. You don't want to stay out of the sun because sunlight is essential to human health and it's our primary source of vitamin D. And of course today people are short vitamin D. And we're finding at least half the population is deficient in vitamin D. And a lot of people, especially at the end of the winter, are really short vitamin D. And this means you get more cancer, it means you get more diabetes, it means you get more of all kinds of diseases, even including multiple sclerosis. So you don't want to be staying out the sun. But when you go out in the sun, what you want to do is you want to avoid burning. You don't want to get a sunburn because that's damaging you. So, and the midday sun is the best. You know, they used to tell us to stay out of the sun in the midday. Stay out of the sun between 10 o'clock and 2 o'clock. Well, it's exactly the wrong advice. That's the time you're supposed to be out in the sun because that's the time you get the most UVB, which is the part of the UV spectrum that produces the vitamin D. So being out in the midday sun is what you want. But limit the time you're out in the midday sun. But it depends on who you are and where you're from. You know, Northern Europeans can only spend a short time in the midday sun. Otherwise, they can get sunburned and they can damage themselves. If you're black and you're from Africa, you need to spend a lot of time in the midday sun because you've got a lot of pigment. And the pigment in your skin protects you from that UV radiation. That's why you have it. People who are born on the equator have a lot of pigment. That's to protect them from that sunlight because they're out in the sun. But it's the same thing. If we take a Norwegian and move them to the equator, they're going to burn up like a crisp. And they're going to get sick. And if we take a black and move them to Norway, they're not going to get enough sunlight and they're going to get sick, because they're not going to get enough vitamin D. So particularly if your skin, and of course as you go north from the equator, the skin gets lighter and lighter and lighter. Pretty soon it becomes olive, and then by the time you get up to Norway, you're just white. So it depends on who you are, what your ethnic background is, as to how long you should stay in the sun. People with dark skin need to spend a lot of time in the sun to get the vitamin D they need. People with light skins need to spend only a short time in the sun to get the vitamin D that they need. But we're seeing a lot of vitamin D deficiency today, particularly in black people in the United States, because most of the United States is too far north in the wintertime to get adequate amounts of vitamin D. And we, right here in the San Francisco area, we're too far north to get adequate amounts of sunlight during the winter. So particularly if you have dark pigmented skin, you've got to really work at making sure you get enough vitamin D, get enough sunlight. And the best thing to do, of course, is to measure your vitamin D levels, no matter who you are. Measure your vitamin D levels. 25-hydroxy vitamin D, that's the name of the test. Yeah, that's what you ask your doctor for. Measure my 25-hydroxy vitamin D and make sure that you're in the upper part of the normal range. And if you're not in the upper part of the normal range, get more sunlight and or take vitamin D supplements. And thank goodness Beyond Health has just come out with a brand new vitamin D supplement that is really superb. So I highly recommend it. And sunlight prevents all these horrible diseases, and sunlight also suppresses autoimmune diseases. So how many people have autoimmune diseases in our society today? It's epidemic, and sunlight helps to suppress that. So sunlight is very important. It's an essential nutrient. It's part of the physical pathway, and all of us have to make sure that we get the sunlight that we need to keep us healthy. And it's up to you to decide how much you need. But a Northern European, 10 minutes each side, there's someone outside that needs to get in. A Northern European, 10 minutes each side, you probably get all the sunlight you need. If you're black, you might need to spend an hour in the sun, not 20 minutes, to get the sunlight that you need. So we all have to make sure that we're getting what we need for our bodies to keep us healthy. Avoiding noise. A lot of people in our society today live in very noisy environments. There are people that live near freeways. There are people that live near airports. There are people that work in noisy environments. And we don't realize that this is harming us. Noise is very harmful. It has a negative effect on health, and it also damages the ears. And the damage to the ears is cumulative, and it's permanent. So this is physical damage, cumulative and permanent. Chronic noise elevates blood pressure. Chronic noise elevates stress chemicals. And stress chemicals produce free radicals. And free radicals damage us. So stress chemicals result in oxidative damage. Now, noise also contributes to osteoporosis. So now, who would think of noise causing osteoporosis? But it does. Because if you're exposed to chronic noise, you're going to lose calcium and magnesium from your bones. And so you can get osteoporosis by being exposed to a noisy environment. Noise contributes to leaky gut syndrome, and it contributes to allergies. So keep yourself away from noise as much as you can. And if you are exposed to noise, you might want to wear protective hearing to help you. Radiation. I mean, this is another big problem, huge problem today. There is ionizing radiation and there's non-ionizing radiation. The ionizing radiation damages us and produces free radicals. And we know that ionizing radiation damages DNA. We know it causes cancer and many other problems. And one of the biggest sources of ionizing radiation for any of us, probably the single largest source for any of us, is medical x-rays. So avoid medical x-rays. We know that about 90% of all medical x-rays have no medical justification whatsoever. So you can easily avoid 90% of all medical x-rays. If you're in an auto accident and you've got broken bones, well, go have an x-ray. But if your doctor wants to do routine x-rays on you, routine dental x-rays, routine chest x-rays, you might want to think twice about that. I routinely refuse all x-rays. Because the damage is cumulative. The more radiation you get, the higher your risk of developing cancer as a result of that cumulative damage. Avoid microwaves. Now, microwaves, that's your cell phone. Your cell phone produces microwaves. So avoid microwaves. Don't live near a microwave tower if you can possibly avoid it. And don't use a cell phone as much as you can possibly avoid it. Now, I have a cell phone and I do use it, but I use it very carefully. First of all, I don't keep it on, I keep it off. And every now and then I'll turn it on to see if I have any messages. Because as long as it's on, it's producing radiation. And there are people walking around with these things on their hips producing radiation all day. That is like crazy. You don't want to do that. So keep it off. And then I have a cell phone that's a speakerphone. So when I do use it, I put it on the speakerphone mode and I keep the phone as far away from me as I can and I speak into the speakerphone. So that's another thing you want to be doing. You want to avoid microwave radiation and the cell phone towers. There have been studies done in Europe, excellent studies done in different countries, Germany being one of them, where they found that if you live within 1,200 feet of a cell phone tower, your chances of all kinds of diseases just skyrocket. Skyrocket. So this is dangerous stuff. It's very dangerous stuff. In fact, we should probably, you know, we've passed laws here in California against smoking in public places. We should probably pass laws about using cell phones in public places because that microwave pollution is probably more dangerous than the smoke pollution. So we need to start protecting ourselves and the people we love and not exposing ourselves to this very dangerous radiation. And yes, a cell phone is a big convenience, and that's why I have one. But I use it very cautiously, and I try to keep my conversations short. You know, there's no reason to have a long conversation on a cell phone. You can probably conduct all the business you need to conduct in just a couple of minutes. And then get off the phone. So keep it short. Keep your exposure short. Avoid electromagnetic fields as much as possible. Again, we are electromagnetic fields. We are electromagnetic fields. A human being is an electromagnetic field, and we produce a field. Well, isn't it logical to assume that if we are electromagnetic fields and we all have this feel around it, psychics and people call it an aura. It's an electromagnetic field. That's what it is. And so if we are, shouldn't an outside electromagnetic field affect us? And the answer is yes, and it does. So we have to try and limit, and we can't. I mean, we're right in this room now. There's channel 4, there's channel 5, there's channel 7, there's channel 3, you know. It goes on and on and on. And there's all kinds of radio stations, and there's the police broadcasts, and the fire broadcasts, and cell phone broadcasts, and all in this room. We're all being exposed to it. We can't see it, so we don't think about it. We're all being the biggest pollution we have created in the world. Is electromagnetic pollution, and there's no way you can get away from it. But what you need to do is limit your exposure. So I ran my dishwasher last night. What I do is I'll load the dishwasher, and then just before I go to bed, I'll turn the dishwasher on, and then I go to bed. And the electromagnetic field being produced by the dishwasher is down in the kitchen, and nobody is going to be in the kitchen affected by that electromagnetic field. So you can do sensible things like that to reduce your exposure. Don't keep an electric clock near your bed, near your head. You can get brain cancer from that. So do sensible things. Don't keep a clock radio near your bed, near your head. Breathing is another thing that we have to think about in the physical pathway. Now, none of us think about breathing because it's automatic, and we breathe. And if we stop breathing, we die. So we don't think about it too much. But breathing is actually a big problem today because most of us, when we're born knowing how to breathe. And unfortunately, as we get older, we are taught how not to breathe, and the result is we all end up not breathing, and this presents a very, very serious problem. So most of us need to relearn how to breathe so that we can do it properly. And we need to do what we call deep belly breathing. If you look at a baby and watch them breathe, you'll see their little tummy going up and down. You look at an adult, you'll see their chest going up and down, not their tummy. Wrong. The tummy needs to go up and down, not the chest, because that gives you the deep breathing that you need. The chest breathing is shallow. And that produces a lot of strange chemistry. And we're suffering from that strange chemistry. Chronic stress depletes the body of nutrients and destabilizes the brain and destabilizes hormone chemistry. And you get muscle tension and depression and insulin insensitivity and GI issues and insomnia and adrenal fatigue, and all of these things are the result of what? An overworked nervous system that is the result of not breathing correctly. So when you don't breathe correctly, you produce a host of problems. But with enough practice, anybody can learn how to breathe, because we were born knowing how to breathe. So you just need to go back to what you were born with. Simple and easy to do, you just need to expand your tummy. So what I do is I'll take a deep breath and I'll mentally put it down into my tummy, and then I'll feel my tummy expanding. Now try that. Put that breath right down into your tummy, and then just keep going, and you'll find the tummy will expand, and then the expansion will come up and up and up, and finally, at long last, your chest will expand too. Well, that's a good deep breath. But most of us just breathe right up here, and that's not a good deep breath. So this gives the body the ability to absorb inhaled oxygen. And if you breathe in through your nose nice and slow, and then exhale through your lips also slowly, and as you breathe, feel the motion of your tummy. If your rib cage is expanding early on, you're doing it wrong. That's the last thing to expand. So keep trying and focus on your breathing. I practice, sometimes I'll sit at my desk, particularly if I'm on the telephone. I'll remember, practice my breathing. So I'll practice my breathing while I'm on the telephone. And if you don't do this, you get nervous. You get anxious and nervous. And we think that a lot of our anxiety, a lot of our nervousness is the result of our busy schedules, when really it's the result of not breathing correctly. So try to make deep breathing a habit. You can do it at any time. You can do it at work. You can do it while driving your car. You can do it while watching television. You can do it any time of the day. You can do it while you're walking, you're out walking. Poor breathing can do two things. If you're breathing very shallow, you will not get enough oxygen because you won't be expelling enough carbon dioxide. So you won't be getting enough oxygen, and if you don't get enough oxygen, this affects the entire body. But then a lot of people do what we call over-breathing. In other words, they breathe too fast. They're breathing too fast. And you can count how many breaths you make. Just lie down and count how many breaths you're making per minute. And if you're making more than 10 or 12 breaths per minute, you're going far too fast. Far too fast. So you want to make sure that you don't do rapid breathing. And rapid breathing is very bad because if you do rapid breathing, you expel too much carbon dioxide. And when you expel too much carbon dioxide, this reduces the oxygen to the brain because it affects the ability to deliver oxygen. You need carbon dioxide in the body in order to tell the oxygen on the hemoglobin to detach from the hemoglobin and become available to the body. So if you overbreathe, get rid of too much carbon dioxide, then you don't give the signal for the oxygen to come off, and you end up with an oxygen deficiency. And this reduces the oxygen in the brain, and it affects your ability to think. And it causes heart palpitations, and muscle spasms, and poor memory, and anxiety, and dizziness, and high blood pressure. The heart works overtime trying to pump more blood to get more oxygen, so you get high blood pressure. You get osteoporosis because the blood becomes too alkaline, and then because it's too alkaline, the body says, hey, this is too alkaline, so I'm going to dump calcium and magnesium out in the urine in order to balance the pH of the blood. So overbreathing can give you osteoporosis. So there you see, and I have people come to me and they'll say, you know, I've got heart palpitations and I've got muscle spasms and I've got poor memory and I've got anxiety. Do you have a pill to help me? You know, is there a supplement I can take? And very often, all they really need to do is breathe. Slow down their overbreathing and breathe better, and all those problems will go away. All that anxiety and poor memory and all that just goes away. So it's remarkable what you can do for the body if you just help it along. And we do that. Very noticeable health benefits. If you're breathing correctly, you decrease stress. Very important. You decrease anxiety and depression. You lower your blood pressure. You increase your energy levels. It's very helpful to asthma sufferers. You get weight loss if you breathe correctly. It clears and focuses the mind. It reduces natural pain, actually produces, if you're breathing correctly, you produce natural painkillers in the body that help to make you feel good. And it helps to prevent and treat cancer, because as we know, cancer is a deficiency of oxygen metabolism at the cellular level, and if you reduce the amount of oxygen available to the cell by overbreathing, you can get cancer, and you can drive cancer. So breathing correctly is very important for cancer patients especially. And breathing correctly also pumps the lymphatic system, because you're using all these muscles in the abdomen, all those are being used, and helps to pump the lymphatic system. So the good news is that you can improve a lot of things simply by breathing correctly, and you can improve your lymph system by learning to practice deep breathing. So the expansion and contraction of the diaphragm, very, very important for keeping the lymphatic system moving. And when you're breathing up here, you're not using the diaphragm down there. Fasting is another thing that many of us can do to help improve our health. And this is something that people have used for thousands of years. But we've seemed to have gotten away from it in our modern worlds, and